January 13th, and we are finishing up our second week in our online Bible study, Living Power. This has been an incredible 2 weeks. I have loved every minute of it, and I do hope you are thoroughly enjoying this study. If you are just joining us and just finding us, welcome. We are so glad to have you. A lot of you posted comments last week, this week on the blog, and I just want to thank you for sharing your personal stories. They've meant so much to me, and I know that they've meant a lot to the other members of the class. I want to encourage you to feel comfortable in doing that and sharing what God leads you to share. And reply to each other also as you feel led to. I want you to know that I am praying for you throughout this study, and I covet your prayers for me and for the Bible study. Just thank you so much for your support of this ministry, and I just pray that you are blessed in coming every day and listening to the videos and blessed by your readings. Tonight, I'm taping at night, and usually I tape during the day, but I have found a quiet moment in my home, and I can't believe it that I'm able to tape this at night, and I'm kind of trying to just steal a quiet moment and see if I can get this lesson taped for you tonight. I want to remind you that we do not post videos on the weekends, so when we get to a Saturday or Sunday reading, there won't be a video, and I won't send you an email over the weekend. The next one will be Monday, but you do need to continue in your readings. We do stick to the schedule in our one-year chronological Bible, but you just read those weekend readings independently. Now, my husband asked me recently, well, how many are in the Bible study? And I told him, well, about 90, and that I was so excited with that number. It's just exceeded my expectations. I'm so happy. And he said, well, honey, I'm going to give you a goal. And he said, when you get to 100, I will buy you some cupcakes from your favorite cupcake store that has just opened down the street. Now, you might think, cupcakes, this isn't a big deal, but oh my, these cupcakes are my favorite. My friend Michelle brought them to a journey group one night, and I have fallen in love with these cupcakes. So I'm asking everyone, help me earn my cupcake and tell all your friends about the study, because once we get to 100, I get a free cupcake. So I'm excited. Today's lesson, the reading is a little bit shorter, and there's a lot of genealogy, and we're certainly not going to cover the meaning of everyone's name, because there were a lot of names that are very hard to pronounce in today's reading. So the reading was shorter, the lesson might be a little bit shorter. I'm going to start us off with a puzzle. Would you like a puzzle? Turn over to page 49, and I want to see if you can find something. In Genesis 36, 31 to 43, this is the section that is called the Rulers of Edom. And it lists the kings who ruled in the land of Edom before any king ruled over the Israelites. Read this section. What do you find surprising? And as you're looking, I'm going to continue on with the lesson, and we'll come back to that in just a few minutes. Okay, so this reading today is about Esau, Jacob's brother. We haven't heard from him in a while because we've been watching Jacob grow up into a man of God. But Esau has been busy. He has been settling in the land of Seir, and he has multiple wives. And you have to kind of be careful if you're trying to be deliberate in tracing the family line on paper. Sometimes it can get confusing, because I've noticed that in the Bible, when they list names, sometimes a person has two different names. They're listed in two different scriptures with a different name, but it's the same person. And this is what's happened with a couple of his wives. So I'm not going to say that I know how many wives he had. I'm just going to say he had more than three. I'm pretty sure he had more than three. But because of the name change, it's kind of hard to figure out. What I do know is that he had five sons and 11 grandsons. And this is where it gets important. These 11 grandsons on page 50 in Genesis 36 to 40 became the heads of tribes, and they became tribal chiefs. You could refer to them as dukes, if you understand it that way. So they were kind of lords over a certain region. And Esau founded the Edomites, who lived in Edom. And the Edomites were eventually come to be at war with Israel. So there's a couple of interesting contrasts here between Esau and Jacob that I wanted to share with you. Esau's sons were born in the land of Canaan before moving to Seir. Jacob's sons were born out of the land and eventually moved back in. Esau, like Lot many lessons ago, left because there was simply not enough room for all the people and the animals. So Esau left and settled in another area. We begin to see a picture of Esau as an overlord emerging. And there are a couple of scriptures elsewhere out of the book of Genesis that I wanted to share with you where God talks about Esau. And it just demonstrates that God's sovereignty and his purposes always come to pass. So here are some comments about Esau in other places of the Bible. In Deuteronomy 2 verse 5, it says, "Do not provoke them to war, for I will not give you any of their land, not even enough to put your foot on. I have given Esau the hill country of Seir as his own." And then in Joshua 24, 4, it says, "And to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. I assigned the hill country of Seir to Esau, but Jacob and his family went down to Egypt." So this is not happenstance where these people are coming to live. It's never happenstance where you and I end up raising our families and coming to live either. This is all in the providence, in the plan of God. God has laid the boundaries for his people Israel, and he has given a spot of land for these people, the Edomites. Now, the original people of Edom were probably defeated by Esau's descendants. And then on page 49, let's go back to the puzzle and see if you have figured out this puzzle. In this section, the rulers of Edom, it's chapter 36, verse 31 to 43. We're on page 49. We're unsure how these rulers are related, because the thing that is so strange, this is the answer to our puzzle for today. None of the kings were succeeded by their sons. Now, isn't that odd? Most of the time, we see the son or the daughter, especially today, succeeding the throne. But here, we don't see any of the sons succeeding the throne. It doesn't say why. It's just very odd. And we can contrast this with the line that God established through Judah. Jesus, the King of Kings, came through the line of Judah. Judah was one of Jacob's sons. Judah is one of the tribes of Israel. And in Judah, along the line of Judah, God established this kingly line. David came from the line of Judah. Solomon, Jesus came from the line of Judah. And every king in the line of Judah, how should I say this? I wanted to tell you the perfection of God's establishment through the kingly line of Judah, in which every king in this line comes from the royal house of David. So in the world, in contrast to the world, here are these Edomite kings. We don't have a single one being succeeded by his son. But in the line of Judah, we see son after son after son being taking over the throne. Now, those are all the facts that I wanted to share with you, the history of the reading, but there are some things that I think we can pull from our application from the lesson today. You know, this reminds me that secular worldly greatness comes much faster than spiritual greatness. You know, it takes time to mold character. It takes time to change a person's heart. And certainly possessions are to be handled with good stewardship. And our families are to be taken care of as best we know how. But how much time do you spend cultivating a heart of God? You know, in the Psalms it says that deceit lives in our heart. And with the help of the Holy Spirit, we have to get it out of there. We have to get deceit out of our heart. And this is Caesar. He's my cat. And he may as well say hi. This is Caesar. Say hi, Caesar. And he wanted to come up and say hello. But I need to get him out of here so we can finish our lesson today. A heart bent on serving itself simply cannot please the Lord, and it will not be effective in sharing that love with others. Caesar's back again. Our purpose is to love God and to love people, the two greatest commandments. And I think in these last lessons, we've seen Abraham, a man of faith, careful to obey God. We've seen Isaac, who was obedient to his father almost until death. And then Jacob, the recipient of the covenant, through whom God will build a nation and God will call his people. What did all three of these great patriarchs have in common? They had a faith in God, and that was why God called them righteous, because they had a right relationship with the Lord through faith. Next time, we're going to meet another great man of God. His name is Joseph. And he gets into real trouble. He is one of my favorite characters. Can he possibly triumph in the end? Well, stay tuned until next time. You guys have a great evening. I can't wait to see you. See you next time.